I'm Riz Ahmed, and for my BFI Screen Epiphany, I've chosen Haine by Mathieu Kassovitz. So Haine is the story of three friends in the housing projects or banlieue of Paris the day after a race riot has taken place. There's basically been an act of police brutality against one of their acquaintances, a young man in the community. That young man is in a coma. And in the wake of this rioting, we spend 24 hours, just a day in the life of these three friends as they waste time, look to get laid, look to get into trouble, looking for revenge, looking to not get caught by the police who are always on their tail, and looking to really define themselves as young men. It's a swaggering, unapologetic, heavily stylish, deeply authentic, and still incredibly powerful and timeless social critique. I saw this film at quite a formative age, around about, I would say, my teenage years. It was a time of, I'd say, fraught race relations here in the UK as well, with the Stephen Lawrence inquiry. And I just kind of came across the film by mistake. I think it was showing late night on Channel 4 one day, or BBC 2 with subtitles. I couldn't sleep and I just stayed up all night watching it. And I found it to be kind of life-changing for many different reasons. First of all, I hadn't seen a depiction of inner city life and fraught race relations in a European city before. I hadn't been exposed to European cinema in that way. I had seen films like, for example, Do the Right Thing, or I had seen, I don't know, Mean Streets or Goodfellas, but to see it so much closer to home, it just felt so tantalizingly close to, you know, the London that we recognize and some of the kind of circumstances that many of us might have witnessed just closer to home. And on another level, I'd say I found it quite life-changing just because of the cinematic flair that went hand in hand with it. I think a lot of us kind of grow up just even without even realizing it, kind of soaking up a kind of social realist cinema or a kitchen sink drama that has a documentary realism to it, that kind of feels like hyper real and is shot, you know, and I don't mean this necessarily in a disparaging way, but sometimes through an anthropological lens. And what was kind of interesting about this film is that it felt so authentic, the acting felt so real, the world felt so real, and yet it didn't shy away from a heightened cinematic language, a language that allowed flair and personality in its filmmaking. It was heavily stylized in black and white. And it kind of almost felt like, I don't know, Raging Bull meets, you know, one of these classic Italian neorealist films. It just kind of leapt off the screen with a kind of style, a swagger. It was unapologetic. And it was really saying something, you know, it was really saying something about what it meant to be young and marginalized in a European city. And it really, really spoke to me. I'd always grown up kind of watching films and renting, you know, VHS tapes from the local post office, and also kind of almost acting out films as like a young kid. I'd kind of keep a notebook and act out these films in my head and then write down the title and the rating. And so I had this kind of, this love of movies with the capital M, but what I hadn't fully really clocked was that movies could be about experiences like mine, or people who look like me. They didn't have to be about RoboCop or Batman or, you know, Terminator 2. And it were these kind of popcorn movies that I really idolized at this time. But as a teenager, what I realized was that you could tell stories about ordinary people, do it with style and flair, and do it with the same kind of impact as any popcorn movie, just from the kind of force of the film's honesty and how unapologetic its depiction was of day-to-day life. And so it was kind of life-changing for me in terms of realizing what cinema could be and what it could be about and how it could be about something much closer to home. And it wouldn't be less because of that. It would be more powerful, more impactful. And so that was mind-blowing for me. I think another thing that it did for me was, it kind of opened me up to like foreign language films, you know, films in French, subtitled movies. You know, I'd kind of thought of that as a world that was just slightly removed from the kind of films that maybe me or my friends would be watching. And it just kind of opened my eyes to just the world of cinema on a really fundamental level.
Hein, pourquoi t'es jamais de mon côté? Pourquoi t'es toujours du côté des enculés d'abord?
Attends, de quel enculé tu parles, putain? Si t'étais allé à l'école, tu serais... La haine attire, la haine.
Mais j'ai pas été à l'école, alors quoi? Moi, je suis de la rue, moi. Qu'est-ce qu'il y a? Je suis de la rue, c'est ce qu'elle m'a appris, moi, la rue à moi. Elle m'a appris que tu donnes ta joue, tu te fais niquer ta mère, et puis c'est tout, alors tu me laisses, vas-y, bouge.
I don't revisit the film religiously or frequently, but every now and again, you know, I might be in conversation with someone with talking about, okay, what film we're going to watch, and I realize they haven't seen it, I will 100% say, yeah, I'm up for watching that again. So over the years, I don't know, I'd say I've probably seen it about 6 times or something like that. Not, you know, I don't watch it every year or anything. But what is remarkable to me is how contemporary it feels. Sure, like there might be certain sequences, like the kind of break dancing, graffiti with the boom boxes and stuff that kind of feel a little bit more of that era. But what it is talking about, it couldn't feel more contemporary, particularly in the wake of the Black Lives Matter, global protests, in the wake of George Floyd's killing. You know, this is a film about, sadly, a kind of a timeless tale. And that timeless tale is about police brutality against people of color, in marginalized communities, and how violence begets violence, and about this cycle of this cycle of, I guess, conflict, you know, of scarring, and of how scarred people will go out and scar others, and just of kind of, I guess, day-to-day struggle. But what's amazing about the film, I guess, is, and another thing that makes it timeless is it does not wallow in a kind of, you know, it doesn't wallow in a kind of self-pity, you know, it doesn't wallow in the kind of tragedy of inner city life. It is hilarious. It is a hilarious film. It is shot through with the banter of, you know, bored young men just looking to get into trouble, or looking to get laid, looking to get out, just looking for something to do, and hoping that the police who are looking for them don't find them, you know? And just in that kind of like day-to-day scrapes and kind of shits and giggles and banter, the fact that it can explore themes like police brutality, gun violence, you know, inner city decay, and do it in really what is just a hilarious roller coaster of a kind of three-way buddy movie, is part of, I think, what makes it timeless. It is not a film that is obsessed with the furniture in the room and the urban landscape. It is obsessed with the people in the room, the characters, their relationships, their families, their insecurities, their hopes. And I think that's partly what elevates it to something that just feels so so timeless. You know, one scene that just pops into my head right now, because I was talking about how sometimes, you know, depictions of inner city life can sometimes fall victim to this kind of anthropology exercise. And there's actually a really kind of meta moment in La Haine where a film crew come to visit the housing projects when the boys are all just sat around, just bored. And a news crew rolls by. And a news crew rolls by and they put their cameras on the boys and they start saying, can you tell us about the unrest that happened last night? You know? And the rioting, did you take part in it? And straight away, the boys kind of get defensive and they start kind of throwing pebbles at the camera crew. And they say, what, this isn't a zoo. What do you think this is? Do you think this is a zoo? Get out of here with your cameras. And I think it's quite a kind of brave and meta moment about who gets to tell stories about these communities and what lens they use and how they frame these stories. And it's quite a bold moment where the characters say, but this is, we're telling our story, you know, you don't get to tell our story. Well, I think La Haine opened me up to the possibility of personal cinema, of cinema that comes from a deeply authentic and intimate, you know, everyday experience. As I said, I think I grew up on kind of Hollywood popcorn movies and, you know, horror films and action films. And it was my first introduction to, I guess, what you'd call a kind of social realism, but it was couched in a cinematic language that had flair and style and swagger. And so it's something that I've always kind of aspired to explore in my own work. And it's something that, you know, has inspired me with my forthcoming film, Mogul Mowgli, to try and explore a cinematic language of our own that speaks to our own experience as South Asian and Muslim men who live in diaspora. So Mogul Mowgli is a very personal story. It's drawn from experiences that I've had and the director Bassam Tariq has had. And something that we always felt was that, you know, again, I found that, you know, stories of Muslim diaspora, of South Asian people can sometimes fall into two camps. It's either a kind of out and out comedy. And I love some of those projects. I love East is East. I love Bend It Like Beckham. You know, or it can fall into this kind of stories of kind of pitiful misery, basically, and kind of a kitchen sink realism and an anthropology exercise where you get to kind of examine these people and how severe their experience is. And what we actually wanted to do was to kind of transcend those two and create a cinematic language that borrows from South Asian art, that borrows from Islamic art, that takes some of the motifs and framing and ideas and principles and mythology of our own culture and infuse that into how we tell the story. So for example, Mogul Mowgli, some of the frames we use, for example, borrow from Mughal miniatures, or the idea of, you know, the imperfection in the frame that is a motif in Islamic art, or the way that things are framed so you never see the whole picture. On top of that, we borrow a lot from, for example, the prominence of dreams in Islamic mythology. And, you know, in a way, our realism is a kind of magical realism. You know, our tradition and our culture is one that accounts for a kind of mythology and a supernaturalism in how we view the world. And so we wanted to bring that into how we told the story of Mogul Mowgli. So I guess Lion has showed me that you can tell really personal stories and that can still be cinema, and you can pick your own language for it. It doesn't have to be a documentary exercise where you're explaining and translating your experience into the language of Western social realism. You can create your own cinematic language for your own personal experience and share that with the world. You know, there's so much I could say about this film. There's so many hilarious moments. There's so many dark moments. I would just say, watch it. Please watch this film. If you haven't seen it, it might just change your life. Thank you for watching. The BFI are going to be bringing Lion back to big screens this autumn.